interesting conversation.
Our pleasure.
I guess I'm going to start with a question. And I thought perhaps we could, I was thinking while watching the film today, and we discussed the fact that, you know, thus far I've watched it on my tiny computer screen where the image, you know, dealing with the miniature somehow. And I assigned its like mysteriousness to that. But watching it somehow today, slightly larger scale, it maintained that mysteriousness, and I realized that that I couldn't, you know, put it away in a way. And perhaps we could start by kind of bringing us closer to the film by, in a way, telling, if you could tell us how you came to make it, perhaps even what are we seeing?
Do you hear us?
Yeah.
Oh. So, first of all, thanks for coming and looking at the film and being so patient. That's very nice. And I actually want to start with something practical because it's a copy installation. And of course, I'm always very reluctant always to mention the people usually in the credits. And of course, that before starting, I would like to thank the cameraman, Ralf Netzer, the editor, Karin Lönnecker, and the sound designer, Jochen Jetzusek, who are not here. I think I haven't seen any one of them tonight here. But really a great team, already working with them for years. And it's also, of course, their achievement, what we see here. And always a pleasure also to travel, especially with the cameraman, in these different contexts. So, coming back to your question, I think each work is sort of a product of what has happened before, but we are actually already having sort of a model of history. So, what you have been bothered with or occupied with in one project potentially always leads you, you know, to the next step. And before doing this film, I was already working for a while on the subject of history or the instrumentalization of history or how, you know, you perceive, you construct, you deal with history, the role of history in society. And doing so, I was more occupied with subjects that were based in, let's say, modern times, but also in antiquity, very much in antiquity. And, you know, there are already kind of, there's a canon that you might criticize, but it's there. So it means you can easily react or refer to something in a good or bad way. And doing these projects, I kind of try to work with these categories, with these formats, I would even almost say. And in the project before that, I somehow stumbled from, let's say, antiquity, which was the last era or period that I was working on, into like prehistory. And suddenly I felt that many of these tools that I had or these criteria simply do not work anymore, they do not function. And that was of course a challenge and also something mysterious. And trying to solve it, I'm already saying something too early. And then I got the invitation to do something for Biennale in Busan in Korea. And actually I started, we talked a little bit about shortly, I started with a totally different concept that really dealt with the more recent and modern history of Korea or the Koreas. and but somehow though I had like wonderful, found wonderful references, and it is a very indeed interesting subject, I was not really satisfied with, because everything was again about the struggle of the interest of trying to occupy history. And then I guess by chance stumbled just upon these images of dolmens, and I was, like many people I think who encountered it first, was surprised, because it was something that was already for me clearly defined as something Irish, from the Bretagne, and I thought, okay, there's a dolmen in Korea, okay, how come? And then I discovered that actually most of the dolmens in the world, or a large amount of them, is not in Europe, but is actually in Korea. And well, then you start to research it, and then you find, of course, very interesting things. And ending my answer is actually that I found that it might be more useful to refer to these prehistoric or objects than to recent history, because they're, on the one hand, they're disputed because you cannot categorize them as neatly as you can with later objects or things. But of course, they're disputable because you know so little about it. So that was the beginning.
So I guess we're kind of moving with you on this journey to the various dolmen sites that you visited, but then also kind of stepping into this museum where we see these dioramas and these other painted images. And I guess there is just to kind of re-articulate some of the things you put on the table, in that shift from thinking about antiquity to prehistory, we're dealing with this kind of divide that is usually characterized by the absence of language, or the absence of writing, rather. And yet we have this kind of trace, let's say, left in the landscape, right? And in a way, the not knowing exactly why these were made, I mean, we assume that they are burial sites, and yet we're looking at them from the present, right? And I was struck while watching the film, maybe even more again, this time, by the different presence, right? Because of the museum, because of the presence of the museum in the work, we kind of see how the moment that the museum is kind of made, sometime in the 90s, if I, right? How that project kind of viewed this Neolithic past. And it struck me that I guess we might also, from a future moment, think about how the video is characterizing a Neolithic past. Right, so I mean, I'm also perhaps jumping ahead again, but maybe the question about presence of the past, right? Or the fact that the past persists into the present. And the fact of these structures that we can't quite fathom how they were installed, for example. And that they remind us of the kind of multiple temporalities that, we encounter, say, all the time, but also in a landscape, right? Like the fact that, yes, the people are not there, but perhaps if they did this, then what they did is still with us. And that stone, particularly, does time differently. but yet has perhaps a connection to something that was similar to us.
Yes.
Yeah.
I think what you said now, last is very interesting because that's the essence of the, let's say, the archaeological discourse, of course, trying to figure out something from the findings and apply it in some way. And there are different ways of application. One is, of course, like the conservative, to say, of course, I mean, this is how they used to live, this is how they used to work. And of course, it's also about technological advancements, inventions, development. But of course, it's also always connected with this very seducing idea of trying to project our own existence into the past. And this is, of course, the fascinating, but also the problematic side of not only that, also of historical sciences, that we try to figure out that if we, or to try to figure out how people lived in order to live better. Or not to do the same mistakes, etc., because often it's, you know, very often connected to the history of violence, of course, and of, you know, and the development of civilization. And this is, of course, a tricky question also. On the other side, I mean, these things are just there, and they have, prevailed or survived time. I'm thinking also about the book where somebody compares the archaeology of stone with the archaeology of ashes. Mm-hmm. And the ashes are, of course, the things that have been written on parchment, on wood, documents, and of course they are lost. And you cannot rely on them anymore. The Athenian archives are simply not there anymore. Mm-hmm. But the Acropolis is there, and of course at the same time these grave markers are there. I mean, assuming now there are grave markers, that's you also referenced it in archaeology. I mean, it's just disputed. Some people say it's not, some people say it is. I mean, I would say the common way of regarding these dolmens is to say that there are grave markers. Maybe just a short excourse into the Neolithic, that there are findings of, I say Grab, by Grab in English, somebody can help me. The objects you place together with
offerings.
Mm-hmm. Offerings.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So that actually to look it up, yes. We're talking about it. And so there are indications of that. And of course, the burial culture itself is, of course, one of the most essential parts in global archaeology, I would say, because often it's these things that have been already buried at that time, and therefore they simply survive. And of course they always reflect the idea of the, you know, of the present society of the time. So in that sense also I would refer to archaeology. Among other things, you can apply this idea also on other disciplines or things. But dealing with archaeology deals also, again, through this idea of projection with your own present. So it's kind of always a reenactment, or I think it's also called like a contemporalization of things. Means if you look at the way you look at the past, you also look at yourself and you characterize your own doing. So I like to call it self-portrait of a society.
Right. Also known as reception studies, right? Like the back in the classics. So I have three things to kind of raise in response to the kind of, I think, I mean, very good chance that you gave. One is, in relation to this like projection that is somehow the tendency of our attempts to engage with the past, especially through the discipline of archaeology, which, you know, one way in which I've been thinking about the advent of the discipline of archaeology, which happens kind of through the armature of colonialism in India and Egypt and other places, is that in becoming the kind of authoritative way of knowing the past, it kind of obscured other ways in which we may have already and we continue to know the past, right? So there's a kind of like way in which authority is granted to the, you know, evidence making processes that archaeology kind of engages with. And in this situation that your film invites us into, and kind of thinking through the structures, and you know, you raised the kind of question to me about we can't quite know how these stones were set up in this way. There is this kind of like reticence in, you know, in the structure itself towards us in the present to kind of figure it quite out. And I think this is something that, you know, you've pointed me to, and I just wanted to kind of bring to the table. The other is in relation to a minor point, and minor point for now, maybe because it isn't as tied in with everything you've said so far, but since you kind of raised the kind of question of violence and the way in which the attempt at looking at the past is always often, let's say, a theological one where we kind of try to understand how we got here, we kind of, there's the tendency to kind of see the past as primitive or see the past as, you know, something that we then evolved from into kind of better societies. And there's, you know, efforts right now. We've been discussing The Dawn of Everything by David Graeber and David Vembro, that somehow questions the assumptions of the disciplines of archaeology insofar as these progressions, for example, from hunter-gatherer societies to agricultural societies, and presents a much more messy version of that, of those transitions, to also have us consider that we might have more to learn from the past than we think in some ways, and not things we think we need to learn from the past. And that's, you know, and that's been, I just wanted to kind of put that on the table, because in thinking, I mean, you mentioned very briefly the earlier work that you haven't delineated for us, that there is a question for you around this as well, right? And then I think I'm just like, and the third point, and you can then choose which one you want to kind of take up, is in relation to your comment about these sites as grave markers, and you know, I want us to kind of add, as much as possible, also come back to kind of the question of the work and the form of the work and the kind of decisions, right? To, for example, in this case, make this video installation, and this kind of accompanying video, right? Where you're actually working with miniature. Yeah. I was like, oh, why is the miniature important? But this is why it's important, because like, right, you're working with, you know, tiny, you're playing with I guess wooden blocks that you're making into domes. But if these are in fact grave markers, then what the image contains, right? We see something, but the question of the dead and whether they're in the image is still one, you know, we're left with. Right, like whether we're told that or not, whether we know that or not, this idea of the surface of the image, what we see in it, versus what's actually also contained by it somehow, whether that's indexical or actual, yeah. So these are three things that, you know, kind of came up in response to what you said, and I guess we could take up any of them.
That's true. I mean, I'll start maybe with the first one, because we have a proof that there, tonight in the audience there is no archaeologist, I guess, or at least not an experimental archaeologist, mm-hmm. because that person would have probably jumped up and said, we know it. We know how these monuments were erected, because experimental archaeology is, you know, basically you try out how to do, how to build a ship, to dig a canal, etc. Then you know, because you kind of went through the whole process of you know, finding, researching, inventing. And so, of course, I could tell you now that, and again, I think it's common sense that most people support the theory of how these things, you know, what they are and how they came into being. So, that's a, but I will spare you the technical explanation of how to erect a dolmen. But it's, of course, it's interesting as technology and tools are an essential part of this, of this scholarly field. So, where do I get from there to the other point is that this, I think what interested me in your work was that you also are, you're trying to find out something or to represent something, I don't know, by addressing not what you immediately see or know, but what is hidden. So it brings us maybe back to this idea of the mysterious. What we do, we rely very much on what we see, and what we see is definitely very much determined by what we know. So this idea of knowledge informing your perception, and this is interesting because, like you said, what are these things? They stand there and they're still there. But I also didn't know before. I was trying to figure it out. And so it's because they're very monolithic and they simply cannot be ignored. Of course, some have been, you know, disappeared for a while and have been kind of retrieved or rediscovered. We're talking also about Göbekli Tepe, this famous archaeological site now in Turkey that I'm sure that most people are acquainted with, which was also protected by this mound on the hill, and they didn't figure out yet why it was covered. So this idea of trying to question a mute object, something that doesn't give you any, you know, referential information at first, and of course I'm not talking again about the scientists who are already there with a certain interest, but I'm talking with what we all, you know, as everyday persons encounter, and that is of course in the film. I mean, I'm not, you know, interviewing archaeologists and trying to find out more about the science, but I'm investigating the presence, like you said, actually in everyday life. So these weird situations that you have once a sort of a Disneyland situation where people drive by with this kind of train next to it, and sometimes a dolmen stands next to a vending machine for, you know, soft drinks. And, some of the dolmens, not much, many are kind of fake. You know, they're decoration, for example, marking the entrance to an area where a site like that is. By the way, they're all under you know, heritage protection, UNESCO protection. So that means they have been also, of course, acknowledged for what they are. Actually, to be something quite special, especially in this concentration. And so that's one point, and the other is maybe also trying to go back to Korea, is that I felt that their presence in the discourse is a very specific one and a very interesting one. And so I was partly happy to have abandoned the first plan to address the more recent history in Korea, because there everything is of course much more disputed. It's really a very political debate, and there's a strong instrumentalization within South Korean society, but of course always in this yes, sort of seemingly infinite discourse between North and South Korea. But prehistory allows us, of course, to address things that are not necessarily situated in a contemporary discourse. Not that it makes it easier, but they were sort of an exemption of the rule. So in Korea itself, and that was in the first concept, and of course it's also part of that, coming to a place you don't know and make a research about it and try to find out something that is there, but it also complies with your own older interests or your artistic approach, I felt to be in a quite special place, and I think this sort of explanation or background is interesting to know. It's a society that after 1945 and then after 1950 and 1951, history became an extremely important part of society. It begins with the resources, which means like financial resources that have been invested in research, building up, you know, history faculties, archaeology, and also and it reaches so far that many parts of Korean history are actually protected by heritage law, and everything from a weaving technique to a certain dance style to a certain kind of music is protected, but also in the sense that it is protected as something specific, originally Korean. And of course this is understandable from a society that has been traumatized by different forms of occupation and of colonization. First, like an historic colonization, being a very small country between Japan and China, but then of course the last very long enduring colonization by Japanese, that I don't have the number right now, but at least more than 40 years. And speaking about these origins of archaeology as a Western discipline, part of the colonial project, of course, the first archaeological studies and excavations have been done by Japanese scholars who early on took the idea of this scientific discipline. So that was, of course, as well in Korean society, a very disturbing fact, which leads partly to sort of excessive examples. For example, the first museum, national museum, that also displayed the Korean past, which was based in Seoul, was, I think it was in the 90s, abandoned, in order to build up and construct a new museum. And they tore this Japanese colonial building, also the architectural style was colonial style. They tore it down by explosion was broadcasted live on TV together with a firework. I do not want to criticize it because it's, you know, I think it's, I don't know if it's right, but it's legitimate for a society to deal in its own ways with things like that. And in a way it creates another example that one can learn of course, also oneself. So just to show the importance of this idea of historical work, of archaeology, of trying to also create a past, both in the way of mending or healing, of course, a traumatized society, but also, of course, then, endangering the instrumentalization. So maybe just before we go to the next point, there was also a discussion at the beginning of the preparation, and it was part of the project that the curator of the Busan Bienal initiated, saying himself that he doesn't know enough about Korean society, so he founded this platform where citizens of Busan or wherever in Korea could join, from Koreans to expats, the most different people were part of it, and actually discuss, you know, what a biennial can mean actually for a city, not just being a display of contemporary art. And there was this one discussion in the beginning where I just presented shortly my intention, And immediately you created a sort of a fight, a civilized fight, but from people who were who said in the audience that they're so proud that this, you know, Korean history reaches into that era of the Neolithic. And of course some very aware and critical Koreans who stood up and said, no, it's not Korean.
Right.
And this is of course what interested me in addressing prehistory in this project and other projects. It doesn't allow you to use this already existing parameters that are mostly, of course, combined with national ideas. Mm-hmm. That's the fascinating thing about it.
I want to pick up on what you were saying about this like relationship to the past, or you know what we kind of. I wouldn't even say. I don't know if I would use the word hidden as much as like somehow this like not knowing or not knowing, but kind of. So the discourse program is a project that somehow that you're referring to, it was called Coming to Know. And I guess this, like, I bring this up in relation to something you said earlier about that we tend to look at the past and the image of the present. So a nationalist project is also kind of trying to collate and organize the past so as to like lead up to a national identity or history. So there is a kind of and of course, we see this happening in the very, you know, dangerous kind of political implications where the kind of past is also colonized for the present of a certain, like I said, national identity. And at the same time, it's like, I think with the example that you're bringing us to in the situation of Korea, like you see that there are multiple kind of, power somehow at play. There's, you know, also and the museum is also then a way to kind of counter a certain hegemony in order to establish another narrative, etc. So it's much more complicated or perhaps it always is, and yet there is this kind of way in which on one hand you started with the question of, oh, dolmens, you know, we think of them as like in Ireland and Brittany, and you just said, but they're not Korean, right? So we're suddenly, we have this belt, right? That takes us from Ireland to Korea, or I've been referencing in our conversation a book that's very important to me called Ecstasies by Carlo Ginzburg, where this is not where he begins, but where he ends. Where he manages to like perhaps resurrect a belt of shamanism that moves from like the Nordic region to China. So you know we're kind of seeing the connections across the kind of physical surface of the earth, right? Through these structures that we're attending to in a way through the film, and that's in a way what the film is doing, right? I would say attending to. It's also we're visiting these outgraves and we're visiting them, etc. Maybe something to kind of think through what this means for also you've been very careful in also marking your own distance from the context of Korea or the curator. You know, not the not knowing of the context, but in a way, and you know, often that's a kind of murky terrain for an artist coming from outside. But I feel like with the question of prehistory, who's more or less distant is I think a question you could ask, and somehow the distance that you have, as well as that the work maintains. There's something, I don't know, true in that, in a way, all we have is also that, is also the distance. Just to kind of think through how one also I wonder if, like, at some point you've got closer to the dolphins.
Yeah, that's of course a very interesting question. I mean, the work is now 12 years old,
yeah.
and I didn't pursue researching about on them afterwards. So, and also like the situation has changed for me. When I started, for example, to read or research about it, even the literature was a different one.
Yeah.
So that we talk now about this book by David Graeber and David Langer, it didn't exist then. And when I read it later on, recently, I was myself surprised that some of the assumptions I also had are simply even more disputed than I had expected or known at that time. So, I mean, that maybe is in that context, this idea of a distance or the notion of a distance is in general a very interesting one. Because next to the temporal and the geographic distance that we found with these objects or with archaeology and with history, you have of course also the personal distance. The one you refer to, coming from one place, being moving in a terrain that is not yours, and of course being trying to also, encounter this murkiness or the dangers it brings with it, also forces you, of course, to create a certain distance.
Mm-hmm.
I cannot identify with this object, of course, in the same way that somebody does who might need them for other purposes or so. So, and what I would try to build a bridge where we also come back to the work,
mm-hmm.
in the sense that, of course, another kind of distance is doing art.
Mm-hmm.
So, of course, you rely very much on a very appreciated scientific work. I told you about this one book, which was really, it was just, you know, very dry literature, but it was constructed in a beautiful way, dealing with this discourse around history and archaeology in contemporary Korea. And I thought, I mean, you know, this dry PhD work is beautiful. It's like a work of art. But of course, the obligations and the responsibilities that you have as a scientist are different ones. So I know it's a bit tricky to say it, but I think that art, to a certain extent, without, you know, taking away the idea of responsibility, allows you, of course, to create a different way of reflection or discourse or narrative. And this narrative or this approach is also something that has to do with distance.
Mm-hmm.
You have to have sort of a distance to the things you're working with and not a too high level of identification.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if this is something.
Yeah, I mean, there's a. It opens up a number of things also in relation to like the kind of tools of archaeology, in so far, and you know, this is the tools of archaeology as kind of relying on evidence, and when you're in a situation where it's about evidence and counter evidence, sometimes the kind of question of, you know, evidence itself is the one that's at stake, but. Narratives and counter-narratives both kind of collapse onto these same, same forms inherited from certain epistemological kind of regimes of knowledge production. And I think what you're saying is that somehow art in being able to abandon those requirements that, you know, archaeology as a discipline of knowledge production exerts on its practitioners, perhaps is a way to access the past differently, to access the difficulty of accessing the past and making that the thing that we are somehow in the presence of as well. So I guess we're just kind of thinking about like, yeah, the relationship between art and archaeology. What about the different kind of tools in input. But I also want to, like, you know, think about now the other images that we see in the work, right? To think, to have you tell us a little bit more about, you know, for me, when I saw the dioramas, I made a connection to the farmers that we hear singing, but then was very surprised, almost disbelief still, that you told me that that was a museum that was meant to represent the Neolithic,
mm-hmm.
right? Because for me, I was like, that's not what the Neolithic looks like. As if, you know, of
yeah.
course, as if I have, you know, seen the Neolithic, which I haven't. So I think the, you know, we have three times here somehow. This time that we see and don't see, or, you know, is present, maybe through the stones, through the dolmens, through your attending to the dolmens more than anything else. There's a time of the museum and a certain kind of perception, and then there's a kind of time of the present. And also this, I mean, to attend to the singing that is happening somehow,
mm-hmm.
right? That there's a, that there are, yeah, bodies making music, and it raises the question of, you know, how much of this we cannot know, but how much of this is also carried from an earlier time, and from which time, and how far back to the motions of our, you know, the rhythms of our body, for example, how far back do they reach?
It's actually a beautiful example, because, I mean, archaeologists can state when kind of music started,
mm-hmm.
let's say by the finding of the first flute made out of an animal bone. But you don't know how many millions of years maybe people already made music without instruments. So these ideas that people connect with the Neolithic, and of course like the displays they create for that, are, I would say, of course, they're also a desperate attempt of trying to figure out or to deal with the past, to gain something, maybe a reward. So that kind of touches upon this idea of a theological, the theological, which is discussed a lot, that is actually the idea of how do we relate the past to the present in order to understand human development and actually and sustain this development. This, of course, I cannot achieve as an artist or deal with it. But of course, I admit that this idea of parallelization is there. But I hope in a more experimental way that if you see, for example, the figurines and how they work, and suddenly you have human beings in the now who almost do the same work, that it at least starts a thinking process. It has to do a little bit with identification,
mm-hmm.
but after all, as Homo sapiens, we can identify with, even without knowledge, with things that happen, with the way we have been before. But it's not like it's not aiming at the scientific meaning or statement the way archaeologists do by saying, for example, at that time we were living in hordes and that created the first social interaction, and therefore actually the Neolithic, as many claim, is the beginning of modern society. This, because I cannot claim or do not want to claim as an artist.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much.
We're going to wrap up there, but perhaps open.
Maybe.
Well, Simon, for me it was a huge pleasure to re-encounter this work after 12 years,
mm-hmm.
because I saw it 12 years ago in its original installation. And it really emotionally, there was an emotional reaction, but I think it has to do with the way that you formatted the film, the way you formatted the content that you were now talking about, and it kind of made us into dormant. Mm-hmm. You know, you start to dwell because of the taste of the film and the soundtrack of the birds and so on. So you start to, it's as if we are the dormant that are watching this film. And I really love that. It was a very pleasurable experience. So thank you for that. I wondered whether you could say, with distance now, a little bit more about the role of the farmers, of the contemporary farmers. Because, of course, they're put into, for the purpose of making this argument about, you know, non-diachronic time, you're decontextualizing them, of course. How do you feel about that now, with, you know, hindsight?
I mean, about using this material and actually also, I mean, triggering it in a way, I still feel okay, pretty well. But of course, I mean, they were very, very much into, you know, they wanted to really play in it, etc. But I used to say I made them run, but it's not true. They demanded, in order to continue with the shooting, they demanded makoli, which is a fermented alcoholica. So they were really kind of enthusiastic about participating. The thing is, they were not planned. In my research trip, I did not encounter them. It was a very spontaneous decision on the spot because we were filming in the site. And I heard them first singing, and just went to look who's singing there, and so on. And then I saw them, and I asked around. And it's basically retired farmers, but the retirement doesn't work there that neatly. I mean, they still have to do, you know, agricultural work, but not in the same extent as being younger. But they also, as these farms are really sort of, they're really intertwined with this Stolman site, which is also beautiful to see that it's not only, you know, a World Heritage protected site, but it's also a site that people still and have been using for thousands of years as a farming land. They are part of it. And actually, I was fascinated by the idea that they were old, tired farmers, because this, in a way, is one of the points that are part of this idea of civilization. We talked yesterday shortly about this, anecdote. That students ask Margaret Mead what is the first sign of civilization for her, and everybody expects that it's a stone tool, a knife, or a spear, etc. But she says it's a mended dome that you found. And it shows that actually society cared for one of its members and didn't leave it to die, as probably also Homo sapiens would have done in the beginning, but actually decided that it's worthwhile to keep it. And that's why actually there is an explanation why these people also play this role in the film of what happened through the process of civilization, or I don't like the word civilization too much, but of human development, yes, in order to achieve this moment where you have the mended bone many, many tens of thousands of years ago or hundred thousands of years ago, and you have the retired people who are still part of society contributing and being equal beings. I hope this answered. Can you also ask?
I think what's missing a bit here in Berlin is that there was a dialectical relationship between the piece and the Korean audience. I mean, your piece is very much about invented traditions. And I had many discussions with Koreans who were kind of upset about the piece. Because what you are constructing is a kind of not so easy correspondence between the dolmens, between the kind of past that cannot be appropriated properly, and the folk version of the Korean past, with Koreans who look like Korean contemporaries. Mm-hmm. And this subversion, I think, was the strongest element, at least on site. And as you pointed out, I mean, the inspiration came from this discussion with Koreans fighting each other about when did Korea start, which is, of course, a displaced discussion. I mean, the same way as a contemporary political debates about identity in Korea are displaced on an imaginary past, the Neolithic.
I mean, I have to explain at least shortly that Holger Bürgel was the curator of the Sunday and also commissioned the work or gave me the opportunity to work there or develop something for the contest. And I was very thankful for this platform I was mentioning before, where I also met people who gave me very, you know, valuable information and kind of opened up also possibilities that I wouldn't have encountered otherwise. I think, yeah, I mean, I totally agree with what you say, and this upsetting is, of course, a part of your maybe role as an artist, but I go back to this idea of the distance, that distance is also a matter of respect. And of course, I tried to touch upon things that are critical and disputed, but of course, I tried to do it in a way that wouldn't, you know, make my own stance so important or dominant, and keep the respect by opening up a space for people actually to start debating things again, maybe in a little bit different way. I mean, so I think that's already maybe too big a task I'm assigning to it now. But I think this is what art can do, and also which still one of the things that is critical in this process of, you know, global culture, and you simply cannot escape this this thing. If you work in different contexts, you're always endangered, of course, in doing something wrong, in making mistakes, etc. But it depends on the way you do it, and the way you observe, and maybe sometimes it's more the observation that is important than making a critical statement, because a critical statement comes anyway. It's, I mean, the idea that we sit together here is already a discussion, and 12 years later, of course, I mean, I see the work in different ways, of course, than I used to see it then. So this, I think, touches upon these moments that are also important together with this work, this working in a global context, and referring also to the specific Korean context.
Great, good. I had a good look. By God, and brave goods. I wanted to just something interesting about what just happened there is sometimes I think about how we are vernacular, like we are built out of where we're from, so like just in the way we encounter things, it's we can't kind of escape that. And so it's really interesting hearing that there was controversy. I can't help but my outlook was just this is a very gently presented, almost uncanny thing to watch. Watching stone on film is very uncanny. And that's all.
I like this idea of something gentle and uncanny being together. And of course, art is manipulative.
I would like to thank everybody very much. Maybe we can continue the discussion with a glass of wine. And